Everybody get up, it's time to slam now. We got a real jam going down. Welcome to the Space Jam.
And welcome into the second half of the Sports Advantage. Two new panelists, Logan Young and Michael Zust. We're going to hit the NFL and Arkansas Razorbacks this half. We'll start with the Arkansas Razorbacks coming off a loss to Texas A&M. It seems like the story stays the same every week, big loss after big loss. How many games can this team win realistically?
You got to look at three or four. Like, you look at Tulsa, the way they're playing right now, can they beat Tulsa? Can they beat Kentucky? You'd like to think that surely they could, but they just are playing with no heart right now. Nobody out there is willing to seem to – like to carry this team on their back.
And Tyler Wilson's doing the best he can carrying this team. There's only so much he can do. Honestly, when his receiver, the tight end.
Did you watch that A&M game? I was there in person, and that was the least amount of arm strength I've seen him have on any of his throws since he's come to Arkansas.
And I think also some of the pressure that's being put on Tyler Wilson, having to put this team on his shoulders. You can tell with him throwing interceptions in the red zone. Tyler Wilson did not do that last year, so I think some of that pressure is really weighing on him.
He's thrown five interceptions already this year, and he only threw six all last year.
It's definitely not looking good for the Hogs, but realistically, I only see them getting two more wins this season, maybe, and those two, I guess, Kentucky Ole Miss or in Kentucky. But even Ole Miss.
Here's the problem. Ole Miss can score. They can score points, and our defense
can't
stop anybody.
What did we get? Nothing. What did Arkansas get? They got nothing. I don't see them getting a win against Tulsa. Tulsa's averaging 49 points a game so far this season. Sure, their competition hasn't been that impressive, but, I mean, Rutgers put up 30. How much Rutgers put up against Arkansas?
They put up in the 30s.
Too many, that's too many.
A&M's putting up 58 points on Arkansas. Tulsa can have no problem scoring on this
defense. Well, the only bright spot I feel like on this team has been Kobe Hamilton these past couple games, because he's got 591 receiving yards this year.
He's the only one that seems to be able to catch on this team.
Yeah, but he's got 591, which is about 40 away from his career high. So he's putting up he's having a good year, and, you know, maybe an all-SEC type year.
Most of those coming in the Rutgers game, right?
He's the only guy who really seems to be doing much.
So one of the biggest questions among Razorback fans is, where does the blame fall? Where does the fault lie? Is it coaches, players? I've heard mostly Bobby Petrino, because without him, you know, this whole thing would have happened. What are you guys' opinion on this?
You know, I used to all think it's on the coaches, but there's only so much the coaches can do. You got to put blame on the coaches for not getting the team ready, not trying to get them motivated. But then you also got to blame the players for not executing, because they go over and practice what you need to do. But I mean, also one thing that I think people didn't realize till Petrino was gone is how good he was at second half adjustments. Games in the 4 years he's been here. How many games was Arkansas down by multiple touchdowns and came back and won the second half because of adjustments he made?
Yeah, I mean, you really can't tell. You're not in the locker room. You're not seeing how the players and the coaches are really working well. If they're working well together or not. I mean, yes, maybe the coaches are expecting a little too much out of the players, or having defensive schemes or offensive schemes that are too complicated for them. But then again, you also got to look at the players too for the blame. They're not getting it done. They're not executing well. I mean, look at the defensive backs. They had four underclassmen starting last game in the defensive backfield. You're not going to win with such inexperience there. I mean, it doesn't help that Telvin Mitchell is hurt, and Eric Bennett, but you got to expect more out of these freshmen.
Yeah, I just think nobody really understood how much Jericho Nelson, Beckett, how much those guys meant to this team defensively.
That's the one thing this team is missing on the defensive side. It's a leader. No one's standing up and taking hold of the defense trying to push them to do better. I'm not seeing it on the field. I'm seeing no heart out of this defensive squad. No one's trying to push for more. Yeah. No one's trying to get any more than what they got.
Highsmith was supposed to be one of those guys coming this year, and he's done nothing, as well as Tank Wright coming over to linebacker.
I mean, I know they moved in the defensive end, but, I mean, you got to do something. Yeah. I mean, even if you're not performing the way people are expecting you to, you can still try and will your team.
I keep waiting for this team to get, because they've only got one interception on the year. I keep waiting for this team to get that key turnover, pick six, something to get this team going. But yeah,
the turnover differential on this team is awful. It is
horrible.
Just awful.
It seems like the Arkansas Razorbacks are at the bottom of, it seems like, every defensive and turnover category. So we're going to try and move it over to a positive note. We know John L. Smith's not going to be back. Another hot topic in Razorback Nation. Who's going to replace him? Now, on the Jim Rome radio show yesterday, another candidate, Charlie Strong, currently with Louisville. He's in Arkansas. He grew up in Batesville, born in Batesville. He said on the Jim Rome show that he's not interested in coming to the Arkansas Razorbacks, but we all know that's probably coach speak, because Mike Anderson said the same thing before he ended up leaving Mizzou and coming to Arkansas.
Calipari said the same
thing. So who are the top three coaching candidates you think that should come in here to Arkansas?
I think Kirby Smart's a big one, defensive coordinator for Alabama. You know, I think a lot of it depends on what does Jeff Long want to do with it. Does he want to go with the defensive mind?
I think you've got to go with the defensive mind.
But here's the thing. If you try to get Kirby Smart, can you get the type of recruits that Alabama and LSU can get in here in Arkansas?
Oh,
can you go into Alabama and steal those recruits?
Maybe not in Alabama, but you can get the recruits. The new facilities they're making, they have no problem getting top players.
And then my second one is Art Briles from Baylor, because everywhere this guy's gone, he's resurrected these programs. He was a very good high school coach in Texas. Last six player quarterbacks he coached in high school played D1. Comes to college, what does he do? He has Kevin Cobb, Case Keenum, and RG3. All three of those guys in the
NFL. The only reason Art Briles is getting so much hype is because of last year. And the only reason they were that good was because of RG3. It's the same thing.
But you can tell they can still put up points even without RG3.
Terrence Gainaway rushed for 1,500 yards that year. They're running back. Nobody knows that just because it's all RG3 talk. When RG3 was coming out of high school, nobody wanted to give him a scholarship except Art Briles. And he looks like a genius now because he is a great quarterbacks coach.
Getting one call, making any one player right on a
Case Keenum,
does not make a
Cobb,
case.
Those guys are in the NFL right now.
Yes.
And then my third one is probably James Franklin from Vanderbilt. You look what he's been able to do with Vanderbilt in his year and a half. Vanderbilt's not really winning this year, but he had the best recruiting class ever in the history of Vandy this year. And it's hard to go in there and recruit because you have to have top grades to get in there. And it's not like they just say, okay, well, these athletes that come in don't have to get the grades that everybody else does. You still have to perform in those classes, and it's hard to recruit there.
He would have a good job, easy time, I think, recruiting here, but I don't think he's going to be leaving Vanderbilt. What he's been building there for so long, and the nice little paycheck, the pay raise he got not too long ago, he's not going to be leaving Vanderbilt.
Who are your three, Logan?
Well, I'm somewhat similar to you. My top guy is probably Kirby Smart. I like Alabama's defense. It's always been a top.
Who doesn't like Alabama's defense? Come on now.
It is the pinnacle of defenses in college football. It's what every team strives to go for. Do I think he's going to leave Alabama? Do I think he'll leave Nick Saban aside?
Why would you want to leave
Alabama? He was at LSU with Nick Saban. He went to Miami Dolphins with Nick Saban, and he moved to Alabama with Nick Saban. He may want to see greener pastures at a head coaching job, but only team I really see him moving to would be Georgia. He's Georgia native. I don't see him leaving Nick Saban's side until that Georgia side comes up. Probably my favorite pick would be Gary Patterson at TCU. This man has a great coach, and it doesn't help that TCU moved to the Big 12.
Right, well, look at his shoes right now. He's getting paid a lot.
He's getting paid a
and
ton.
And you got a top 15 team in TCU that you have just resurrected and built into this great program that's now in the Big 12. He's not going to leave TCU.
But Big 12 and SEC football are like.
But look at the Big 12 this year and next year, maybe. They're a very good conference.
Jeff Long
this year.
will pay whatever it takes to get a good coach at Jerry Patterson's level. Great coach. 8 out of his 11 seasons at TCU, he's only had 2 losses in 8 of his seasons.
So, on that, I think Gary Patterson will have an easier time winning in the Big 12 than in the SEC, so maybe that's why he would want to stick in the Big 12 there.
Maybe Big 12, but you always want. I like to see some people will step up to the challenge. Yeah. Take on some of those SEC defenses like the Alabama. You get a chance every year to play Alabama and LSU. Get a shot at the two best teams. Better chance to get to a national championship. I don't see why you wouldn't want to come to Arkansas.
Yeah. And let's move over to the rest of college football.
Well, I got an honorable mention.
Okay,
real quick
honorable mention.
Coach Bart. Pat Fitzgerald from Northwestern. You know, you look, you're like, Northwestern, but it's hard to recruit there. Very big academic school. And he's a defensive-minded player. As he was Big Ten Defensive Player of the Year twice and is in the College Football Hall of Fame. That's a guy who he's got a winning record at Northwestern in his 6 years, a young coach, and if you want a defensive-minded guy, he's a guy that might actually take the job offer to come here.
Great players don't always turn into great coaches.
And before we move on,
he's winning at Northwestern. That's hard to do.
Before we move on from the Arkansas Razorbacks, I want to get you guys' opinions on how they're going to fare on the Plains at Auburn this weekend. 11 a.m. kickoff, ESPN2 against Auburn. How's this game going to go?
It's going to be ugly. Like, it's as bad as our defense is, and their defense is pretty bad too. Nobody's offense is good, and our defense may make their quarterback look like a Heisman candidate with the way they've been playing.
They've been doing that with every quarterback.
What score do you think it's going to be?
I think Auburn's going 19-16.
Okay, Logan.
The way we saw Auburn play LSU 2 weeks ago is maybe really nervous. But again, LSU's offense is not the highest of caliber. I'm going a little higher scoring. Auburn 31, Arkansas 21. Still, Arkansas doesn't get their first SEC win.
Okay, so now we'll move on to the rest of college football. 5 of the top 10 in the country are from the SEC. It seems like the SEC dominance is not going away anytime soon. Is the SEC going to win the national title, or is there somebody else that will stand in their way?
The team I like that I think poses the biggest threat, it's not Oregon like a lot of people think. I think it's Florida State. Because Florida State is
the most...
EJ Manuel played great against Clemson. True. He is having a very
good year.
He is a Heisman candidate right now.
He is.
But their running back, Thompson, is very good. He's averaging about almost 110 yards a game. And Florida State's defense is what I really like because they are the most capable team to hang with an Alabama or an LSU or Florida
SEC body.
Defensively? No way. I think only one team that really can match up with them defensively. That's got to be Notre Dame. The way they've been playing
this year. I agree with you on
that,
but Notre Dame's offense is pretty pitiful, and they're not going to have to play SEC
since
teams.
Since when has Notre Dame been good in like the past decade?
This year, they've been good this year. You know, they're 5-0. They already took down Michigan State and Michigan. Alabama gave them more points to Michigan than Notre Dame did. They held Michigan to 6. They held Michigan State to 3 points. That is a tall order. Michigan State, when they were ranked number 10 in the country. I really like the way Notre Dame's defense playing. They forced 5 turnovers against Michigan. 4 of them interceptions against Denard Robinson. That's incredible.
He throws a lot of picks. You're making that sound like he never throws an interception.
He's a great quarterback, and you don't expect to get something like 4 interceptions.
He's a great runner. He's not a great quarterback. He cannot throw the ball consistently.
Consistently, but still, you guys, 5 turnovers, that's still impressive. 4 interceptions, 1
fumble. Yeah, it's definitely impressive. Their defense is great, but their offense can't really score. And when you play a team like USC, you're going to need to put points up.
Do you know what other offense couldn't score that much last year? Alabama's. Same thing.
But that's a different style.
They are the 3rd best defense.
They had Trent Richardson. Who's Notre Dame's running back? Can you name the running back for me right now?
And whoever it is, it's not Trent Richardson. Before we move on, we've got Hank on the line again. Welcome back, Hank.
Welcome, Hank.
How are you doing?
Good.
Very good.
My subject tonight has something to do about some high school games and who do you like in the games tomorrow and with the rain in the area and all that. What do you think about that? And I'll say goodnight to you.
Okay, thanks for your call, Hank. What do you guys think?
About high school football?
Yeah.
Bentonville, how can you go against Bentonville?
Of course. Terrace Wallace, Barry Lundy got a dominant team there.
Yeah, the only word I knew there was Barry Lundy.
Good job.
The first guy he says. So.
Logan, you know anything about Arkansas high school football?
To be honest, I'm not a Fayetteville native. I'm not even an Arkansas native, but I like Fayetteville High School. I like the way their team plays.
Good. That's where I graduated from, so you have a good taste in football. Back over to the big boys in football, the college football here. So it seems like we all saw West Virginia, Baylor, huge offensive numbers. It seems like some of the times the defense isn't showing up like it usually is unless you're in the SEC where the defense reigns king. So my question for you guys, is college football moving into a direction where offense is more important, or will defense still be the main key here?
I think it all depends on the conference. You know, the Big 12, I think people are maybe blowing this a little bit out of proportion because they've always been like this. Baylor last year put up a ton of yards. You look at Texas over the years, they've had pretty good defense. When they had Colt McCoy, they still put up a ton of yards. It's just the fact of how bad these two defenses were. These are the two worst passing
defenses.
And
in the Big 12, you don't really have any good defenses, pretty much.
And, Nick Florence threw for 580 as well. So, it's not like it was just Geno Smith.
And it's not Robert Griffin III anymore.
No, that's the thing, too. You look in the Big 12, you got Oklahoma State. They got an air raid type offense.
Offensive power.
You got, Landry Jones. Not as much this year, but when he had Ryan Broyles, he's thrown to him.
Definitely.
They put up a lot of yards. You got West Virginia, Baylor, Iowa State. All these teams like to put the ball in the air instead of run the football, and that's why Big 12 teams aren't really winning these national championships now, is they're focusing so much on offense. And part of it is when you score touchdown drives in a minute and a half, how do you give your defense rest?
No, it's not happening. Defense has always ruled college football. Just look at the last, 7-8 champions at BCS champions? SEC teams. What do they run on? Defense. The rest of college football can change and make it an offensive powerhouse, but defense wins championships. That's not going to change.
I agree 100% on that, except if you got a Cam Newton. Because Auburn had
that's the one exception.
Auburn had a pitiful defense that year. Like, it is unbelievable how bad their defense was.
They had defensive stars in there.
They had Nick Fairley, one guy. And the reason in that game was their front four were actually pretty solid compared to their secondary, which was horrible. And their front four was their front four was able to get pressure because every time that Oregon was able to throw the ball for 15 yards, they completed it for a big game.
Exact defense. It was the defense.
Their defense was still pitiful.
Fueled by their offense, it was still the defense that won the game, getting pressure on Oregon's quarterback. Rest of college football,
Michael Dyer won the game with his run there at the end. I mean, Cam Newton.
Yeah, seriously.
When you get an X-Factor player like Cam Newton, that's going to change things up. But you see it. Arkansas tried to win in the SEC with offense.